add a little point that, you know, this was kind of like the political extension of the economic opening up of the Indian economy at that point of time. So it was almost like a political extension of the same kind of thing. And the fact that ASEAN countries themselves were perhaps beginning to feel the pinch of an very swiftly growing China. So they
Region. Is it something that India also looks forward to?
Now the ambassador was talking about connectivity. As far as, first of all, let's look at our own security. You have Myanmar, which is the hub, can become the hub and the connectivity to Southeast Asia. Now China is there in a big way, and that is also a threat to us in case it gets access to ports. What everyone knows what China is up to, considering that the kind of abrasive behavior it had shown in the past in South China Sea, but at Brunei it has used its charm diplomacy. So the question is, this is one thing where we are also wanting, other countries also feel it, and we have a direct threat, you could say. After all, insurgents have been armed, then there have been reports of their circling us, whatever it is. So there is, and these are the countries who are like-minded. If you look at his Prime Minister,
The
he talks
statement.
about like-minded countries.
Right.
Among the countries also includes now Malaysia, which during Mahathir's period was probably think his policy has been successful. There have been times when you feel that we have not been implementing all those initiatives we have been announcing. And today's his Prime Minister's statement, I think, is a really forthright and very impressive on many issues.
In fact, we have announced the setting up of a consulate in Jakarta, which is where the
ASEAN ambassador.
Yeah.
And one last point, sorry, I must give others a chance as well, is the fact which ASEAN are very keen is the centrality of ASEAN in the process, like East Asia process or any process in that. And we have reaffirmed that point. Not many, I mean, there's a danger. The others like would like to hijack this, but this is something which worries ASEAN, and India has always said that we support the centrality of ASEAN in this region.
Ambassador Tayal, how important a China is factor when it comes to our engagement with
I
ASEAN?
would say that China is an important country, but our Lucky's policy is independent of what China is, where China is. Because let us all note that Lucky's policy really started in 1992, when China was really not such a big factor, economic or strategic or political. And Indo-ASEAN relations have their own logic, a very strong logic. But of course, China is the second largest economy in the world. It is a growing military power, and it is the objective and in the interest of all the countries of Asia to engage very positively with China. As was said, all the neighboring countries of China, their maximum foreign trade is with China, including our own. Now US has taken overtaken slightly. India's total trade, for instance, with ASEAN is now about
In South China Sea. In the light of these developments, what should India do?
Well, I think India, as Ambassador Tayal very correctly pointed out, India has pursued a fairly independent sort of line of action. I mean, consider fairly recently China tried to get a little sort of abrasive in terms of the Indian oil exploration off the coast of Vietnam. Now, these are things that India went ahead and said, this is a commercial exercise, this is nothing political, and we are going to go ahead and do it. I mean, obviously, the fact that we've constantly emphasized the commonality of the maritime commons, I mean, you know, they belong to everyone, that seaways have to be open, maritime security is something that is paramount for most of these countries, which are major trading nations. So you cannot have any one country coming up and saying that, you know, this is my territory, I will not allow anybody else to do this. This is not something that is going to work. China has tried over the past year to be a little aggressive, but I think Li Keqiang has been on this charm offensive at this particular ASEAN summit and the East Asia summit, in which he said, things like if they will adhere to the 2002 code of conduct, you know, sort of. So I think India has emphasized that again today. So you know, the Prime Minister has also said that. So clearly, we have come out in support for peaceful uses of all maritime sea lanes. Okay. The fact that people cannot really go ahead and try and you know, say that this belongs to them exclusively, this kind of exclusivity. The fact that India used the term, even the threat of the use of force, is something I think is is something that we've stuck up for. I mean, I don't think we've been cowed.
Your comments on what the Prime Minister also said, as Ms. Roy Chaudhary mentioned, he talks about a stable maritime environment, which is essential to realize the collective regional aspirations of all countries. He's also talked about reaffirming the principles of maritime security, talks about this this code of conduct of parties in the South China Sea, adoption of this code of conduct. Clearly, all of this is coming in the backdrop of the developments we saw lately, territorial disputes in the South China Sea. Clearly, all of this is forum we are discussing India-ASEAN relations and India's look east policy. Dr. Kaul, continuing with you on the China dimension of it, you know, on the one hand, we are seeing India being forthright about its right to navigation in the South China Sea and of other countries also. But on the other hand, we have a much bigger relationship with China. How can we, you know, perform this balancing act right?
Yeah, balancing act. We have a problem with them on the borders. I mean, we are discussing with them. We are trying to. The confidence building measures are being adopted. Now, the first thing about our engagement with ASEAN, we have to remember that non-interference, in the sense we would not.
Now, on the economic part of it, this particular visit assumes significance for us because India is looking to ink a free trade agreement in services and investment by the end of this year. What would be the benefits to us of if such an agreement comes through?
Benefits will be there. We had problems. I think we had domestic reasons for also delaying the FTA with ASEAN countries. But the main benefit would also be on the banking, and I would say the main benefit, if we use it, would be to utilize it in Myanmar. Sorry, in the northeast.
Okay.
That is what I would say. Northeast and Myanmar connectivity. We feel these are where FTA would help a great deal in service, particularly in the service sector. This is the big thing. And economically, of course, economic engagement is strengthened. Just look at China when it signed FTA, and look at us when we are still thinking of it. Has been understood that we'll do that in 2000. We were a little wary of it. And there are many areas where we do compete with them. And they are like in goods also, it can impact our own agriculture sector. So it's not as simple as that. But in order to assuage to the South ASEAN countries, it has taken us a long time because we had to also think of our own interest as well. But hopefully it will help this connectivity and this economic connectivity.
Ambassador Tayal, we had signed a free trade agreement in trade long back. This is where the ASEAN countries have an advantage, but for us the advantage would be in the services and investment sector, where there was this perception that ASEAN countries were dragging their feet. Now it seems it's all set to be signed end of this year. What would be the advantages to us?
I think this is very good news because eventually we have competitive advantage in information bridges.
Which 71 bridges. I believe tenders have been put out for that. So I'm told, at least the government says that they're on track to have this particular stretch of connectivity done by the end of 2016. Now, that be that as it may, we also have a great deal of maritime connectivity which we need to develop. I mean, for example, in Myanmar, we are doing a great deal on the Sitwe port, and you know, so the entire area there is something that we need to be connected with. Now, Having done that, we also need to develop the infrastructure to actually facilitate this connectivity, which
Absolutely.
At this point does not exist.
Hmm.
So you will of course require border crossings, you will require all kinds of things which at this point are non-existent.
Hmm.
But to get anywhere, to move anything forward, you will have to get this done.
Hmm.
The air services agreement, which we might not have with ASEAN, but we've sort of broadly come to an understanding whereby 18 new stations are going to be permitted.
Okay.
And primarily, I'm told, those are open, but for the Northeast largely.
Hmm.
So clearly, given our advantages in the English language factor, which is fairly common through most of the ASEAN countries,
hmm.
That plus our strength in services, I think clearly this, without this level of connectivity,
hmm.
air, sea,
hmm.
and roadways and rail, I mean there's this project for railways as well, extending the railways, but
hmm.
All of these things will actually come to fruition when we actually can be connected straight.
Mm-hmm.
At
right.
this point, there is no direct connection between Delhi and Jakarta, which
mm-hmm.
is the largest ASEAN country.
Mm-hmm.
So it, you know, there are some very glaring problems
mm-hmm.
which need to be overcome. I
mm-hmm.
think we've realized that